Hey guys, in previous lecture we have seen about the classification of sources, and we divide the sources in two categories. First one is the dependent sources and second one is the independent sources, and we have seen each one of the sources individually in previous lecture. Now in this lecture we will be covering some basic concept like KCL, KVL, series and parallel connection, source transformation and star delta conversion. Let's understand each one of the topic one by one. Let's talk about the KCL. KCL is Kirchhoff current law, and it states that in the network, in any kind of network, the algebraic sum of the current at a particular node is equal to zero. For example, let's take this. We have one node. What is node? Node is the interconnection of two or more branches. So let's take one example. In this example, there is only one node at which five branches are connected. Okay. And I have shown the current flowing through each branch. So we have to write the KCL equation at this node. So before writing KCL equation, we have to assume that take incoming current as a negative and outgoing current as a positive. Okay, you can take opposite also, like incoming current as a positive and outgoing current as a negative. But why I am telling you to take like this, because I will solve all the nodal equations when I will teach you nodal analysis. Then I will solve all the nodal equation and I will apply there the KCL with this convention. That's why I am telling you that take incoming current as a negative and outgoing current as a positive. If you are comfortable with the opposite convention, then no problem. Okay, see, in this node I1 is the incoming current. Okay, I2 is the outgoing, I3 is incoming, I4 is incoming and I5 is outgoing. So minus I1, I2 is outgoing, so plus I2, I3 is incoming minus I3, I4 is incoming minus I4, and I5 is outgoing plus I5 is equal to 0. In this way you can write KCL equation. So this is equal to I1 plus I3 plus I4 is equal to I2 plus I5. In other word, you can say that the sum of incoming current is equal to sum of outgoing current. Okay, now we know that I is equal to dq by dt. Rate of change of charge is current. Okay, so dq1 upon dt plus dq2 upon dt plus dq3 upon dt plus dq4 upon dt is equal to dq2 upon dt plus dq5 upon dt. At any time d upon dt, we will get q1 plus q3 plus q4 is equal to q2 plus q5. Means incoming charge at that node is equal to the outgoing charge from that node. Means it follows law of conservation of charge. KCL follows law of conservation of charge. Got it? Now let's see the features of KCL. KCL is applicable for any lumped circuit. What is lumped circuit? The circuit which is practically existable. Like suppose you are going to market and you buy one resistor, one inductor and one capacitor and connected in series to make one network. Now when you will see the network, then you can able to see the resistance is practically existing, inductance is available and capacitance is available. So this type of circuit is known as lumped circuit. there is another kind of circuit known as distributed circuit, like in transmission line. In transmission line, there is wire in which you will see the nature of resistance, inductance and capacitance, but in that wire you cannot see the resistance is connected, inductance is connected and the capacitance is connected. Although the nature of RLC appears in transmission line, but it is not actually there. So this kind of circuit is distributed circuit, and in this type of circuit we cannot apply KCL or we cannot apply KVL. Okay, KCL and KVL are applicable only for lumped circuit. Now see the second features. It is independent of nature of element. No matter whether the element is linear, non-linear, active, passive, unilateral, bilateral, it is independent of the nature of element. We can apply KCL to any kind of element, like take this example. Let us take current source having sinusoidal current, and this is resistance, inductance and capacitance. In this circuit, at this node, this is node because it is a interconnection of branches. At this node we can apply KCL. Got it? Now let us check the nature of this current source. This is non-linear, unilateral, active, time variant. But see the nature of RLC circuit. This is RLC element. This is linear, bilateral, passive, time invariant. Although the nature are different, but we can apply KCL here. Okay, so it is independent of nature of element. Also it follows law of conservation of charge, we have seen. Now let's move to KVL. What does KVL state? It states that in any lumped circuit, the algebraic sum of branch voltage around the loop is equal to zero. Let us consider one circuit having resistance, inductance and capacitance, and the voltage across resistance is VR. Similarly, the voltage across inductor is VL and the voltage across capacitor is VC. Now this is the active element. This is voltage source from where current will flow. So in any passive element RLC, the current will enter from positive terminal and leaves from the negative terminal, because these all are the passive element. In active element, like in voltage source, the current will enter from the negative polarity and outward from the positive. Okay, so the voltage drop across RLC is VR, VL, VC. Now apply KVL. So let's move from here, and whatever the polarity came first, I have to use that polarity. Okay, so when I will move from here, I will see minus V. Okay, then I will move again afterwards, I will see plus VR, then again plus VL, plus VC is equal to 0. That means V is equal to VR plus VC plus VL. In this way we can apply KVL. Now let's talk about the features of KVL. KVL is applicable to any kind of lumped circuit. I already explained what is lumped circuit. Also it is independent of nature of element. We have seen while applying KCL, we have seen that no matter what is the nature of element, KVL is also applicable there. Now the third features is, it is following energy conservation principle. See, we can write potential in terms of work done, that is equal to dW upon dq. Okay, now dW upon dq is equal to dWr upon dq plus dWl upon dq plus dWc upon dq. So from here we can say that W is equal to WR plus WL plus WC. So energy transferred by active element, this is the active element, is equal to energy absorbed in the circuit by passive element. These are the passive element. So it follows energy conservation principle. Now let us see how the network is connected. Okay, network is connected either in series connection or in parallel connection, or neither series nor parallel. In any type of circuit, these connections are possible. Let us say Z1 and Z2 are the two element which are connected in series. How can we say that it is connected in series? In series connection, I remains same. When the current flowing from the two element remains same, then we can say that that two element are in series connection. So if you will have to find the Z equivalent, that is given by Z1 plus Z2, because these two are connected in series. Okay, let us take Z1 is equal to R1 and Z2 is equal to R2. Then R equivalent will be R1 plus R2. If I will take Z1 is equal to XL1 and Z2 is equal to XL1. This is the reactance produced by the inductance. When two inductance are connected in series, then XL equivalent is equal to XL1 plus XL2. That means omega L equivalent is equal to omega L1 plus omega L2. So we can say that L equivalent is equal to L1 plus L2. Similarly, when two capacitors are connected in series, then XC1 is equal to, let's take Z1 is equal to XC1 and XC2 is equal to Z2. So XC equivalent is equal to XC1 plus XC2. X is equal to 1 upon omega C equivalent is equal to 1 upon omega C1 plus 1 upon omega C2. So in capacitance, it is not added directly, like in resistance. When two resistors are connected in series, the equivalent resistance is the sum of two resistance. Similarly, when two inductors are connected in series, the equivalent inductance is the sum of two inductance. But in capacitors, when two capacitors are connected in series, then the reciprocal, the sum of reciprocal of individual capacitor is equal to the reciprocal of equivalent capacitance. Got it? 1 upon C equivalent is equal to 1 upon C1 plus 1 upon C2, omega will cancel out. Okay? Now analyze the series connection. Apply KVL here, minus V. I am moving, then I will get minus V plus V1, then I will get plus V1, then I will get plus V2 is equal to 0. So V is equal to V1 plus V2. I can write V1 is equal to I into Z1. Similarly, I into Z2. So from here I can get I is equal to V upon Z1 plus Z2. Okay. Now I can find V1. V1 is equal to I into Z1 and I is V upon Z1 plus Z2. So we can write V1 is equal to V upon V into Z1 plus Z2. Similarly, I can write V2 is equal to V into Z2 by Z1 plus Z2. This is known as voltage division rule. Suppose when two element are connected in series, then the voltage across each element will be calculated by using this formula. So in case of R, we will get VR is equal to total voltage upon R1 upon R1 plus R2. Similarly, VR2, we will get total voltage multiplied by that resistance upon total resistance. In case of inductor, VL1 is equal to total voltage multiplied by inductor across which we are finding voltage divided by sum of inductance. Similarly, VL2 is equal to V into inductance of that element at which we are finding voltage by total inductance. Now see in case of capacitance, when two capacitors are connected in series, then you will get VC1 is equal to total voltage by capacitance of other element by C1 plus C2. This is opposite to VR1, VL1. Similarly, VC2 is equal to V into capacitance of other element by C1 plus C2. Remember this formula. Now see the parallel connection. In parallel connection, two elements are said to be parallel when the voltage across both the element will remain same. Let us see, Z1 and Z2 are connected in parallel. So V, V is the voltage across Z1 also, and V is the voltage across Z2 also. Means these two are connected in parallel. Now apply KCL here. I is equal to I1 plus I2. You can write I1 is equal to V upon Z1 plus V upon Z2. So I upon V is equal to 1 upon Z1 plus 1 upon Z2. That is equal to 1 upon Z equivalent. So in parallel connection, Z equivalent of two element is equal to Z1, Z2 by Z1 plus Z2. Now suppose Z1 is equal to R1 and Z2 is equal to R2. Then what will be the R equivalent? R equivalent is equal to R1, R2 by R1 plus R2. Okay. Suppose Z1 is equal to XL1, where XL1 is the reactance produced by inductor. Similarly, Z2 is equal to XL2. Then L equivalent is equal to L1, L2 by L1 plus L2. But in case of capacitor, suppose Z1 is equal to XC1. XC1 is the reactance produced by capacitor 1, and Z2 is equal to XC2. XC2 is the reactance produced by capacitance 2. Then C equivalent is equal to C1 plus C2. This is opposite to the L equivalent and R equivalent. Remember these things. Okay. So in parallel connection, capacitance are added directly, and the equivalent resistance and equivalent inductance can be calculated by 1 upon R equivalent is equal to 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon R2. That is, you will get same like this. Similarly, 1 upon L equivalent is equal to 1 upon L1 plus 1 upon L2. You will get this. But in case of capacitance, it is added directly. Now see, I1 is equal to V upon Z1, and V is replaced by I into Z equivalent upon Z1. So, and in parallel connection, we have seen that Z equivalent is equal to Z1, Z2 by Z1 plus Z2. This is I upon Z1. Z1, Z1 cancel out each other. So you will get finally I into Z2 by Z1 plus Z2. So in parallel connection, the current flowing through Z1, that is I1, is equal to total current multiplied by impedance of other branch divided by sum of total impedance. Okay. So in case of resistance, let us say Z1 is equal to R1 and Z2 is equal to R2, then current flowing through R1, IR1 is equal to I into resistance of opposite branch by total resistance. Similarly, IR2 is equal to total current by resistance of opposite branch, that is R1, by R1 plus R2. In case of inductor also, you will get same, like Z1 is equal to XL1 and Z2 is equal to XL2, then IL1 is equal to I into inductance of opposite branch, that is L2 by L1 plus L2, while IL2 is equal to I into L1 by L1 plus L2. But in case of capacitance, suppose Z1 is equal to XC1 and Z2 is equal to XC2, then current flowing through C1 is equal to I into same capacitance in which you are finding the current, C1 by C1 plus C2, and I C2 will be given by total current into same capacitance, that is C2 by C1 plus C2. These things you should remember. This is nothing but a current division rule. Okay. Now let's move to source transformation. What is source transformation and why source transformation is done? Source transformation is done in order to reduce the circuit. Suppose any complex circuit is given having number of voltage source and the current source are more than one, that is 2, 3, then to reduce the circuit we use source transformation. Or in another way we can say that source transformation are used to reduce the number of nodes. Let us suppose one voltage source in series with resistance RS is given and I have to change the voltage source into current source, then we can change it by using source transformation, which states that this voltage source can be replaced by current source in parallel with the resistance RS, where current source, the value of current source IS, is given by VS upon RS. Similarly, if we want to transform the practical current source into practical voltage source, then we can reduce it by connecting voltage source in series with resistance and whose value is given by Vs is equal to IsRs. Remember one point, we cannot transform the ideal voltage source into current source, and similarly we cannot transform the ideal current source into voltage source. We can transform when the voltage source and the current source are practical. Okay. Let us take one example how source transformation is done. We have to reduce this circuit A in between A and B. Okay, so we have seen the series and parallel connection. Two elements are said to be in parallel when the voltage across both the branches are same, that means this 2 ohm and this 2 ohm having same potential. Let us suppose this is V, then V will drop across this 2 ohm and V will drop across this 2 ohm. So these 2 ohm are parallel to each other. So first reduce like this, 2 ohm and 2 ohm parallel to each other, that means this equivalent resistance will be 1 ohm. Okay, and 1 ohm is connected with the current source 2 ampere. Got it? Similarly, now do source transformation here and here. This is voltage source in series with resistance, means like this circuit, voltage source in series with resistance. So we want to convert into practical current source. How will I convert? I will take one practical current source, and the direction of that current source will depend upon the polarity of this voltage. Polarity of voltage is minus to plus, that means current will go from here to here, that means that the current direction of current source will be downward, okay, and whose value is given by 6/2 V upon RS, that is 6/2 is equal to 3 ampere, okay, in parallel with 2 ohm resistor. Similarly, convert these practical voltage source into current source, you will get 1 ohm in parallel with current source, and the direction of current will be from negative to positive, means like this, and whose value is given by 5/1, that is equal to 5 ampere. So we make circuit like this. Now find the equivalent of 2 and 1 ohm. You will get these two are connected in parallel, so equivalent of 2 and 1 ohm will be 2 × 1/2 + 1, that is equal to 2/3. You will get 2/3. Now 3 ampere in downward direction and 5 ampere in upward direction, so overall this current source can be replaced by 2 ampere in upward direction, because 5 is greater than 3, in parallel with 2/3 ohm. Similarly, 2 ampere in upward direction in parallel with 1 ohm. Again, apply source transformation, convert this current source into voltage source. So overall, the equivalent circuit will be 1 + 2/3. These two are connected in series, so it will be added directly. 1 + 2/3 is 5/3. In series with voltage source, these two voltage sources are added, because minus 2 plus and again -2 plus, so these two voltage sources are added, and the polarity of the voltage source will be like this, 4/3 + 2 volt. So in this way, this complex circuit is reduced to one voltage source in series with resistance by using source transformation. Now see star delta transformer. In any complex circuit, this technique, star delta transformation, is used to reduce the circuit, okay. So suppose we have to convert a star to delta, okay, means a star is given, this is a star, ZA, ZB, ZC is given, and we have to find Z1, Z2, Z3, then only we will convert a star into delta. So Z1 is equal to, see this Z1 is connected with ZA and ZB, so sum of the known which is connected, ZA plus ZB plus product of known which is connected by that impedance which is not connected to Z1, means ZC. Got it? Similarly, suppose I have to calculate Z2. So Z2 is given by, see, Z2 is connected with ZC and ZB. So these two are known, ZB plus ZC plus product of known which are connected, ZB, ZC upon remaining, that is ZA. Similarly, we can calculate Z3. Z3 is equal to, see, Z3 is connected with ZA and ZC. So sum of known which is connected, ZA plus ZC plus product of known which is connected, ZA, ZC by remaining. Remaining is ZB. In this way, we can convert a star into delta. In delta to a star connection means Z1, Z2, Z3 are given. delta connection is given. Z1, Z2, Z3 are given, and we have to find ZA, ZB, ZC. So ZA is equal to product of known. Product of known by total sum. Okay. Z is connected with Z1 and Z3. So product of Z1 and Z3 by total sum, Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3. Similarly, ZB is connected with Z2 and Z1. So product of Z2, Z1 by total sum, Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3. Similarly, ZC is connected with C. ZC is connected with Z3 and Z2. So product of known Z2, Z3 by total sum, Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3. In this way, we can convert star to delta and delta to star. Why we are converting? In order to reduce the circuit. Let us take one example. This is one of the example, and we have to find the equivalent resistance across A and B. Whenever you will see like this circuit, then assume some potential A here, B at that node, C at this node, and D at this node, and make in a linear way, like A is this and A is connected with a small a. Now take B here, C here, D is here, and D is connected with B. So potential at D and B will same. Now move from A to B, 1 ohm resistor is connected. 1 ohm resistor is connected. From B to C, 3 ohm. 3 ohm is connected. From C to D, 3 ohm is connected. 3 ohm is connected. From B to D, 3 ohm is connected. This is B and this is D. Similarly, from A to C, 3 ohm is connected. This is A, this is C, 3 ohm is connected. Now take this BC perpendicular. If you will take BC in a perpendicular way, then you will see this is D, B. Similarly, this is A and A. So when you will take BC perpendicular, when you will stretch C here, C here like this, then you will get like this. So here you can see that from A to B, you are getting two delta connected resistor. 1, 3, 3 are connected in delta and 3, 3, 3 are connected in delta. So anyhow, to find the equivalent resistance, since the bridge is not balanced, 3 by 3 is not equal to 1 by 3, so this is not balanced bridge, so we cannot replace this 3 ohm connected across BC. So we have to find the equivalent by converting this delta connection into a star connection. So either convert 1, 3, 3 into a star, or convert 3, 3 to into a star. So it's easy to convert 3, 3, 3 into a star. So when you will convert 3, 3, 3 into a star, then you will get something like this. You will get circuit like this after converting this delta connection into a star connection. So if you want to find this resistance R1 is equal to the product of known, that is equal to 3 multiplied by 3 upon total resistance, that is equal to 9, is equal to 1 ohm. So you will get R1, R2, R3 equal to 1 ohm because in delta connection all are equal. Now you can easily find the equivalent resistance. These two are connected in series, these two are connected in series. So and again it is these two are connected in parallel. So 2 parallel with 4 plus 1. 8 by 6 plus 1, that is equal to 14 by 6 ohm. So this is the application of a star delta transformation. Anyhow, you have to convert this delta connection into a star connection, otherwise it would be difficult to solve the circuit or to reduce the circuit. Okay, that's all about this lecture. In the next tutorial we will see nodal method, mesh analysis and Telegen's theorem. If you are having any doubt, then you can join our Facebook group. And for new updates, you can subscribe to this channel. Thanks for watching this video.